welcome to School of the Bible, Leviticus 15:15. This is our Bible mini-series that is 15 verses in 15 minutes. And so we read in Leviticus chapter 1, verses 1 through 15. And the Lord called unto Moses and spoke unto him out of the tabernacle of the congregation, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, If any man of you bring an offering unto the Lord, you shall bring your offering of the cattle, even of the herd, and of the flock. If his offering be a burnt sacrifice of the herd, let him offer a male without blemish. He shall offer it of his own voluntary will at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord. And he shall put his hand upon the head of the burnt offering, and it shall be accepted for him to make atonement for him. And he shall kill the bullock before the Lord, and the priests, Aaron's sons, shall bring the blood, and sprinkle the blood round about upon the altar that is by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And he shall flay the burnt offering, and cut it into his pieces. And the sons of Aaron, the priests, shall put fire upon the altar, and lay the wood in order upon the fire. And the priests, Aaron's sons, shall lay the parts, the head and the fat, in order upon the wood that is on the fire, which is upon the altar. But his inwards and his legs shall be washed in water, and the priest shall burn all on the altar to be a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire, of a sweet savor unto the Lord. And if his offering be of the flocks, namely of the sheep, or of the goats, for a burnt sacrifice he shall bring it a male without blemish. And he shall kill it on the side of the altar northward before the Lord, and the priests, Aaron's sons, shall sprinkle his blood round about upon the altar. And he shall cut it into his pieces with his head and his fat, and the priest shall lay them in order on the wood that is on the fire which is upon the altar. And he shall wash the inwards and the legs with water, and the priest shall bring it all and burn it upon the altar. It is a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord. And if the burnt sacrifice of his offering be to the Lord, he be of fowls, then he shall bring his offering of turtle doves or of young pigeons. And the priest shall bring it unto the altar, and wring off his head, and burn it on the altar, and the blood thereof shall he be wrung out on the sides of the altar. This is one of the books that is so typical that is misunderstood, misapplied, and oftentimes mistaken for what is entailed herein. Oftentimes we find ourselves challenged by what God is saying in Leviticus, which is written to Levi, the tribe of Levi, which is one of the sons of Aaron, which are priests unto the Lord, that things that are done here are involving sacrifices and the way that priests should behave themselves when they're appearing before the Lord their God, representing the people to God himself and offering certain things that are done in order to make atonement for the sins of the people. Leviticus is often called the Book of Jews. One reason being is that if you read it six times, you'll still be a Gentile, but the seventh time you'll become a Jew. In other words, there's an old joke that is said, and even James Michener wrote about it, that if you read Leviticus through six times in a row, by the seventh time you read it, you'll become Jewish. Now, that's not true, but at least it begins to give you an idea of the mindset, of the reality, of the things that are supposed to be done in a specific order, exactly as it is detailed before us now, written in the Word, in verses 1 through 15. It is interesting to me that oftentimes when you hear of a Gentile or a Christian or an evangelical or a pastor teaching on this, he'll talk about what the sacrifices are, what they do, what they accomplish, who they're types of, what they're specific. But I'm more interested in what's legitimate to you, what applies to us. What do we do today? Do we take cattle and do we offer them unto the Lord? Can we make Leviticus a part of our life today? Is there certain portions of it that fit in our reality and our own personal existence? Well, I have a question for you. Do you ever barbecue? Good question. Do you ever have, a barbecue like on the Super Bowl, do you have a tailgate party? Do you ever have family get-togethers on the 4th of July or Memorial Day when you go out on the weekend and you get this big old giant bunch of people together and you roast a pig? Or you slaughter a cow? Or you have fried chicken or hot dogs? You know you do. That's similar to what we're talking about here. Atonement means to bring someone at one with you. It means to make an agreement that this is going to take care of what you've done wrong between us. This is an offering that is giving something up so that we can receive something in return. It is not meant to be simply for sin, but it is meant to involve the reality of what is going on here. That for everything you do, there is a consequence. For everything you think, there is a price to be paid. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. And that applies spiritually, physically, emotionally, and congregationally. You affect everyone around you. But what I like is, God spoke, as we look at the beginning of verse 1. And the Lord called unto Moses and spoke unto him out of the tabernacle of the congregation. Notice, it's from a tent that God calls out, Moses, Moses, come here, I want to talk to you. It isn't from the heavens, it isn't from inside his head, it isn't from next door, it isn't from a pastor, it isn't from a preacher, it is from God speaking out of the tent. The tent of the congregation. Some people would say that means he speaks out of the church, and they will apply that as being in the church age to mean that, oh, well, God now speaks to us from the building or the structure or the assembling together of the brethren so that God speaks to us out of the church. Sometimes he does. We'll agree on that. Sometimes. Oh, but God speaks to us out of the temple of the Holy Spirit that we are. Well, sometimes he does and sometimes he doesn't. But the tent, the tabernacle, is what your body is. You are a tabernacle of the Holy Spirit. God will speak to you out of your innermost being, but he can also speak to you audibly, even as it came forth from out of the tent, audibly for all those who were listening, Moses. He didn't say, Aaron, come here. He said, Moses, come here. I want you to tell the people this. And so he speaks to Moses out of the tabernacle, out of our souls, out of our beings, and he makes it audible to those that are listening. They can hear, you can hear, we all can hear, whether it comes from a church, whether it comes from a steeple, whether it comes from the people, whether it comes from a temple, whether it comes from a tent, whether it comes from God Almighty, you can hear what God has to say, what God is speaking, because he will call you by name. Speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them. It's always interesting, is that whenever God speaks, he doesn't say, do this, like you'll hear the, obviously, legalists say about Torah, if they are messianic legalists that have come in as Judaizers trying to make Christians become Jews, which no Jew would ever make a Christian become a Jew. Let me state that again to you. No Jew is going to come to you and tell you to be a Jew if you're a Christian, unless they are a Judaizer, unless they are rabbinical Jewish, meaning that they're of the Orthodox persuasion, that they follow Judaism and not God or not Jesus. Because no Jewish person who is following Jesus will tell you to become a Jew, you must, or to be saved, you must become a Jew. And no Jew will tell you to become a Jew. No Jew will tell a Gentile to become a Jew. Got to get that straight here. Because you are who you are. God made you that way. It's the same thing that's true if you're a man, you're a man. You were created a man, so be a man. If you were a woman, you're a woman. If you're created as a woman, be a woman. If you have the unfortunate misfortune or the positive, you know, absolute choice by God to have functional realities that are in your physical body of being both genders, then that doesn't change who you are. It just means that there's a confusion or a profusion of different realities that have gone on in sin that your flesh appears one way, but your soul and your spirit is still a child of God. So the reality isn't male or female to make one absolute that you have to be that or be the other. No, it means that what God created you to be, you are who you are. Don't change it, you can't. Don't rearrange it, you aren't. You are who you are. A Jew cannot be a Gentile any more than a Gentile can become a Jew. That's just the way it is. But all people, whether Jew, Gentile, barbarian, Scythian, or free, can become children of the Most High God. They can become sons and daughters of God. They can be followers of Jesus. So when God is speaking, he uses an interesting word in this text, in Leviticus. And I want you to remember that all the way through the book of Leviticus. If. It's a big word. It's the most important word that we find it written here in verse 2. If any man of you bring an offering. If. It doesn't say you have to. It doesn't say you ought to. It doesn't say you must. It doesn't command you to. It says if you do. It's always about willingness. It's always about choice. God never has said to you and commanded you to do something. He said, if you do this, there's always a choice and a consequence. If you make the right choice, you get the blessing. If you make the wrong choice, you get the curse. Either way, whichever way you choose, it's going to be either God's way or your way. And here in Leviticus, he's making it very specific. If you're going to bring it to God, you do it my way. If you're going to do it for yourself, do it your way. And that's the problem with people today, is that they hear from God and then run out and do their way what they want to do today. Is that what you do in your way? Do you hear from God and then run out and make your own religion? Have you created your own book of Leviticus that you have your own rules and regulations, your own laws, your own mandates, your own Seder, your own order, your own segregation where you separate yourself from the Pentecostals, from the Evangelicals, from the Charismatics, from the Catholics, from the Protestants? From those people that maybe God is showing you that, hey, these guys are priests, that's why they act that way. These guys are fingers, that's why they act that way. These guys are feet. These guys are stub toes. These guys are nose. Speaking of which, I'm pretty proud of my proboscis because I know how to smell out things. I can smell out a false prophet just like that. But knowing where you are, what you are, and how you are means that you are specific to a particular purpose. That's what Leviticus is trying to say. This is what you do, and this is what the priests will do. This is how you approach. This is what you must have in order to be offering something to God. You can't just offer God, you know, whatever you want, willy-nilly, and say, hey, you know what, God? I think that I'm going to be a strip joint owner, and I'm just going to stamp Jesus on the outside. It doesn't work that way. Any more than you can say, I think I'll be a football player, and I'll just stamp Jesus on it. No, you are a Christian who happens to be a football player. It is not a Christian vocation. Just like when you tell me you're in the military and Jesus told you to go there. No, he didn't. He told you you're going to follow him. What you did then is up to you. Your choice was your own. If you choose to take a life, then a life will be required of you. If you choose to kill, then you will be killed. If you choose to live in peace, then you will live in peace. But the reality of what God is saying to you is that there's a consequence to the choices that you make, and if you choose to follow me, I have a way for you to go. And in Leviticus, we're going to see that every step of the way. There is a way to approach God. There is a way that God requires of us if we're bringing a sacrifice. If you're going to be a legalist, you better get down what it's saying here because you're going to be found outside of the will of God if you're not doing what God has said. And there are people, believe it or not, in America actually offering up burnt sacrifices. Now, I understand that most of you think that's your wife when she's trying to cook for you the first time, that she's just burning the cooked meal that you have, and you just go, ew, got a little carried away on timing, didn't you? Smells a little burnt, tasted a little burnt, you know, I think you burnt it, dear. Burnt sacrifice. Well, that's not what we're talking about, even though that's a little funny or humorous or maybe not. Maybe the man burned it. I know a lot of times I see charcoal offerings, you know, that are on grills that people have offered up at the barbecue and said, hey, this is my barbecue. And I go, wow, man, that thing is one dried out meat burnt to the crisp, you know. Yeah. And we know that most people that eat prime rib like it medium rare, kind of a little bloody on the side. Sounds a little gross to some people, but hey, that's really what they call juice. Juice is blood. Sorry, it's not the fat that just kind of like perforated into the meat. No, it's blood. You better know you're one bloody sucker, you know, because if you're eating blood, you're eating blood. Bloody. And I eat medium rare, so let's be clear. I'm Jewish. I eat bacon too. So what? Believe me, Galatians applies. But in this that we are looking at, when we talk about burnt offerings and we talk about what Aaron the priest shall do and what the man shall do and what the people shall do, there are reasons that we could get into detail, but we don't need to. It's a burnt offering. It's something for God to God by God, and God requires of us to do it His way. And that's the point of what we're trying to say in opening up Leviticus mini Bible series, verses 1 through 15 in chapter 1. That God has His way of doing things. God will tell you His way of doing things. God will speak to you. God will call you by name. God will give you specific instructions. They will not be vague interpretations. They won't be mystical dreams. They won't be realities that you have to imagine what the meaning is or go out and seek someone to tell you what it means. I'm sorry, those are unbelievers that have had dreams that they did not know the interpretation thereof. I'm sorry, but today, in God's way that He's speaking to us in a more excellent and perfect way through His Son, we have the meaning of dreams. We have the interpretation. We have the example of what it is to be a follower of Jesus. We don't need to go and look and apply and ask. We know, according to the will of God, what He has chosen for us and what He would have us to do. Because He has called us by name, even your name, specifically, and told you what to do. He has called me by name and has told me specifically what I am to do. Each and every one of us have a choice to do according to what God has given us to do daily. And that's why the word if applies so much to everything we do. If today you hear His voice, if we would harden not our hearts, if we would walk in His way, if we would listen today, if. And it's a big if. Because the requirements after we talk about if are specificities, specific. Integral specificity of the scripture simply means that the integer is integral to the parts thereof, and you cannot remove it out of its context because it is specific to the location with which it is the integer of a part of. That means that the very chromosomal literature that we're reading, which is just like DNA and RNA, works together for specific instructions that are encoded upon it. And in these scriptures, where they are, the way they are, as they are, there is an encoding that goes in depth for he who would read it to look into the depth thereof and to find even more instructions and details that are applicable not to the exclusion of the greater whole, but are included in all of the parts of the volume of the book. So then we see that Jesus is in the midst of this. We do see that there are typologies and metaphors and similes, but they are also literal. If you want to have a barbecue, try it. See how it works out for you. You'll be amazed that maybe God will come and participate with you. He may come and speak to you during the midst of your weekender, Super Bowl, Memorial Day, or Father's Day, or whatever day you do to choose to have a barbecue. Because I got news for you. There are Jews today who literally do this in reference to inviting God to their barbecue. And that's what I would end this study with you with, is that I would say unto you that you could do something personal today. You could do something real today. You could take this Bible study and make it a part of your life as you would choose to use it in a way that you never thought of today. And that is to bring Jesus into it. Bring God to your barbecues. Bring God to your parties. Let Jesus have a drink with you if you're drinking alcohol. Let Him be there wherever you are, however you are, the way you are. Because if you don't, you're going to find He's there anyways. So invite God in and bring Him with you to every barbecue that you have, to every Levitical offering that you give to God, because every day is an offering that you present to Him today as a living sacrifice. You are this sacrifice that's being offered unto God for atonement, because God has already provided for your salvation. He has already provided for your atonement. He has already given a way to escape the damnation that's to come upon the world. He has provided Himself a sacrifice to be your offering unto God for sin.